This morning, our subject deals with keys to a longer quality life. And as we go through life, we go through various stages, various things that we encounter in life. And as you go through life, every once in a while, perhaps you pause and you reminisce. And when you reminisce, you think of things that were. And I really feel one of the great keys of growing older with a quality of life is being able to adjust to each stage. In other words, what I see sometimes, and I'm sure all of you that are here this morning and those of you that are watching at home, you see people that are fighting going into a different stage of their age. As an example, a person who doesn't quite look the same as they did when they were 17, and now is maybe somewhere in a different age bracket, and attempts to look like and dress like they're 17. Now, we all know how ridiculous this looks, but understand that there is a mindset behind every time you see a person who tries to dress way, way beyond what their age really is, I mean, in terms of to the point where it is to the point of ridiculous, and they're fighting it. They're really fighting it. I believe that all of us should look as good as we can, allowing for what we are inside. And as we grow older, if we're leading a quality life, then we will age, as the term goes, gracefully. We will take the years and we will age in a way where we don't feel uncomfortable with what is taking place as far as the physical appearance of the person is concerned. You know, you can think to yourself, well, there's all kinds of things you can do to spruce yourself up. I mean, you can go to the exaggeration of, like, Joan Rivers as an example, who does the commercial where she's with somebody now and she's like, I can't feel my face. Is it still, am I smiling? I don't know. Well, Joan is in show business. And, you know, the Botox works for her, and that's fine. It depends upon each soul. It depends upon how each soul wants to go into every stage. When you're in show business, perhaps the youthful look is part of being in show business. But when you take and you go through these stages, it's like, when I first came over to, when I was 18, to Las Vegas, and I saw these old men chasing after, they were probably in their 60s and their 70s, chasing after 18-year-old chorus girls. I mean, this is one of the things that gave me an immediate flashback to higher consciousness, to say, my God, you know, am I going to live the entirety of my life and then still be around chasing 18-year-old girls when I'm in my 60s and my 70s. That's what I'm talking about making an adjustment to every age as you go into it. Now, if you start to fight making that adjustment, if you start to fight it, then it will react. Now, I'm not saying to suddenly, if you're at a certain age, to say, well, I'm a certain age, I've got to act old. I'm not talking about that. I mean adjusting to every age as you go through it. The ages in the 20s, as an example, trying to find your place in the world. In the 30s, perhaps concentrating on raising a family. In the 40s, the family is raised, and now you have to try to find perhaps some type of new meaning in your own life. And you make all of these adjustments as you go along. The body itself is a very, very wonderful thing. As long as the mind is sort of coordinating with the body and the soul and the soul's purpose for this lifetime. Now let's take and look at our affirmation sheet here as we get into this subject. And for those of you watching at home, if you don't have an affirmation sheet, you can request it by going to www.metaphysics.com, and we'll be happy to email you one preceding every broadcast and at the same time give you a preview by email of what the content of the broadcast will be on. Now the first affirmation says constant renewal. I think one of the most fascinating things that we learn about the human body is how it is constantly being made new. That fascinated me when I came into recontact with it in this lifetime. And I'm sure it fascinated you how all of the cells are constantly being replaced. So, you know, if all of the cells are constantly being replaced, you begin to think to yourself, what's going on here? As a matter of fact, when I was first studying psychology decades ago, one of the things that what I was fascinated with was the idea that all of these cells of the body were subject to being replaced except for nerve cells. And now they've begun to find out that even nerve cells can be replaced. I mean, we can almost begin to think that this whole body is such a magnificent piece of work, as it were. A piece of work that was divinely created, because only if something that is of a higher order of life could create this body to constantly be renewing itself. So why is it then, if we have constant new cells, are those cells acting old? In other words, here I'm a new cell, but I'm an old cell at the same time. Because what we're broadcasting into it, as far as our attitude each and every day, our state of consciousness each and every day, what are we broadcasting into it? If we see somebody that's 60 years old and just barely moving, we say to ourselves, well, that's what a 60-year-old, how a 60-year-old is supposed to move. And if we accept that into our consciousness, that's different. On the other hand, we could see a 90-year-old that's out there driving, has all their wits about them, even going to work. I know a lady that's 92 years old, she's still a school teacher. Little short Jewish lady, maybe about 5 foot tall. She can barely, you know, one of those ladies that when she drives, and she does drive, she can barely see over the steering wheel, but she sees enough to get to school every day and to get home every day. Now, if I take and I look at somebody that's 60, and I say, and they're barely dragging along, and you know some people are in their 60 and barely dragging, and I accept consciously or unconsciously that's the way a 60-year-old is supposed to move, and I'm 60 at that time, that's what my body is going to respond to. That's the signal I'm going to be giving to all of the cells. On the other hand, if I see this little Jewish lady here, 5 foot tall, just filled with energy, a bright mind going lickety-clip, I say to myself, my God, I'm only 60. Look at this is what I'm going to be like when I'm 90. And so the cells, consciously or unconsciously, all these new cells respond to what you're accepting. Perhaps the word accepting is the word that we want to look at here. What do we really accept? In other words, we're peering out through our senses every day. And as we peer out through our senses, we're saying to ourselves, well, look at here. This is reality or this is non-reality. And isn't it interesting that as a person does grow older, that there is this difference where some people are barely making it along at 60 and others are just going along like a little engine that just couldn't be stopped, and they're in their 90s. What is the difference? Well, we can say it's DNA, we can say it's karma, we can say, but all of this is meshed in together into who and what you are. So the affirmation says, through the grace of divine design, by God's presence within me, the consciousness of my physical body, I accept that new cells are constantly replacing old cells throughout it. And frankly, this should be an affirmation, and you can put it in your own words, that you should say to yourself each and every day, or remind yourself that new cells are taking over your body each and every day. I mean, it's a tremendous idea. And it's those of you that are here, those of you that are watching at home, and you know the mind-body connection, you know the power of that. And then if we introduce the soul, the mind-body-soul connection, and we put all of those together, that means that when we go into a state of meditation, that energy that we tap into, that unconscious energy that you feel as you meditate, that energy then is a youthful energy. It's an eternal energy. It's the energy of the eternal. And you're touching those cells, those new cells of your body, with eternal energy. Think about that. I mean, this is magic. When you consider the wonderment of what is really taking place here, if you just step beyond an intellectual analysis of the process and allow your mind to just wander, it's fantastic. The next word says release. It says, I release all negative thought energy of both the present and the past so as to not have negative energy interfering with the positive energy of new cells throughout my body. All right? The influence of other people in your own age bracket, you accept, first of all, that only the ones that really look healthy, those are the ones that you identify with. The next thing is, you don't let the negative energy that you have inside of your mind and your body thwart the new cells again. Every new cell has this new wonderful energy, just like a little infant, a new baby that is just fresh and new. Each little cell is like a little baby, a little infant, ready to be impressed. But if in your subconscious mind you haven't been releasing all the negativity, all the hurt, all the sorrow, as you've been going through your life, then that negativity is going to enter those cells and immediately cripple them. Does that make sense to you? Just plain common sense, which is universal sense? That is why one of the great mistakes in what I detected in what I call Western New Thought metaphysics is the idea of, as long as you're a garbage can, don't think that you can just have strawberries and whipped cream on the cerebral level of your mind and say, everything is good, I'm young. And at the same time, inside of yourself, you're having all of this accumulation of negative thoughts. So until you clear up the garbage can of your mind of all of the past things that go back into your childhood, you know, Freud wasn't 100% right. We all know that by now. Others have come along with their own theories. But one thing for sure that he was right about was that there is this influence that can go back to our childhood and even perhaps beyond the childhood into previous lives and the karma. So when we say everything in the past, we mean not just this life, but everything that preceded this life and the journey of our soul through eternity. So every day, take time and release. And remember, as you're releasing, you're giving yourself a beauty treatment. Does that motivate you? Yes, I hear an amen. One woman is collapsing over here. Oh, yes. All right. Now, if you're not going to have have any negative thoughts, the next one is a necessity then, because it's the word forgiveness. It says, I forgive everyone of everything in my entire life. In my entire life. Knowing that old negative energy adversely affects positive energy of new cells throughout my body. So, is there somebody that you haven't forgiven? Remember, even, as I said, in childhood, there are experiences that we have. Some people are molested in childhood. They will carry that grudge with them all of their life. They will not resolve it. Now, of course, you can go to a therapist and have them work with you to get this childhood situation resolved in consciousness. Or, if you have spiritually reached a certain level, you can say to yourself, look it, I realize that so-and-so in my youth was a fool, was an idiot, was unaware, was not thinking, did not realize the ramifications, did not have the awareness to know the harm that they had set, that they were setting forth, did not have that. And therefore, I have to forgive this person. I have to forgive them because they didn't know. Sure, they knew what they were doing, you can say with one side of your head. But the other side was still blinded by. And when it comes to primal instincts, that takes over. We had a case of it here in the last few days where a former presidential candidate absolutely messed up their career. Presidential candidates live politicians in fishbowls, but unable to control. And it's not just this one in recent news. We've had them from all political parties, for those of you that are outside of the country, from all political parties, all political persuasions, and so on and so forth, cannot control, even though they're living in a fishbowl type of existence. So what do we do? We have to forgive. You say to yourself, well, there are certain things that are... Which of you is without sin who shall cast the first stone? Which of you is without sin that will cast the first stone? Those were one of the most powerful words ever uttered by the Christ. Isn't that fantastic? Then when you pinpoint, then suddenly everybody has to stand back. And so forgive. On the cross, he looks down. Forgive them, Father, they know not what they do. So whatever it is, we want to have those new cells positively affected. We forgive everything and everyone. If we get to the point where we say, Dear God, I am myself, my personal self, cannot find the power to forgive, then take me to that place within myself, into your presence, where that forgiveness is possible. Meditation. Through my daily practice of meditation, I bring forth the natural, healing, restorative, it should be, the word says, re-engineering energies, it should be regenerating energies of God's presence within me into the new cells throughout my body. That's what I mentioned a few moments ago. Every time that we go into a state of meditation, that higher healing consciousness that is inside of us, that's pure, pure consciousness, the Buddhist calls it nirvana, pure mind, pure consciousness, then, as you're in a state of meditation, is now more active and entering into the vibratory rate of all of these new cells. So the new cells are purified. They have the divine imprint, the divine stamp inside of them. I mean, this is wonderful. That's why we feel so good if we actually go into a deep state of meditation. That's why we feel so good, because we're getting more into that wonderful, wonderful state of newness, eternal newness inside of ourselves. So every day, if you want to get the maximum out of all of the new cells in your body, then take time. Take time each day to meditate. Meditation has so many benefits. It clears your mind, it helps you to digest better, it lowers your blood pressure. Good God, it has so many things, and it keeps you looking good. It keeps you feeling good. A self-image. Now, I've alluded to this previously. It says, I think and speak in a positive way about my age, such as to referring to myself as X years young rather than X years old. Now, when we were small children, you remember how much age meant to us? Somebody would ask us, how old are you? I'm 6 and a half. We got to get that half in there. 6 and a half. I'm 7 and a quarter. I mean, we tried as hard as we could to age as quickly as we could. And when someone asked us, it was our opportunity to show we were mature. Then, as we get into different stages, we go into role reversal. Now, you know, I'm 70 and a half young. As a matter of fact, for those of you that are watching, I will give you my age. I'm 73 and a half. All right. Moderation. You know, I have done an awful lot of research over decades with tens of thousands of people in working with all different kinds of philosophies, psychology, religious spirituality, all kinds of different approaches. And do you know the thing that stands out as far as the idea of living a good life is moderation? The word moderation, not to have excess. Now, all of you know that if you leave here today and you go to some wonderful restaurant, some five-star place where everything is just absolutely wonderful on the plate, and you have your plate, and you say, oh, this is so good, give me another order. I'll have the same. One more time. Hit me again with the plate. Well, if you sit there and you have all you can eat and then some, you're going to get ill. If you exercise too much, it's not good. Everything in life, moderation. To be moderate in all things is one of the keys, I believe, really, to living a quality life as you go through the stages of life. If you do too much, immediately your body and your mind gives you a signal you've done too much. You've overdone it. So it says, I practice the great spiritual, and that's what it is, because it's in all of these different philosophies. The great spiritual principle of moderation in all that I do, including eating, drinking, exercising, and overall lifestyle. Whatever you're doing, you don't overdo it. You find that central point that's comfortable to your body and your mind and your health, and you stay within proximity of that particular level of whatever it is that you're engaged in. The next, I believe, is very, very essential for a person as they pass through different stages of their life. Because I feel that without this, we suddenly get very old very quick. The next word on the affirmation list says meaning. I have seen that the moment a person is void of meaning in their life, they can get old in the really worst sense of the word very, very quickly. How many of you, by a show of hands, agree with this? I'm just curious.
Absolutely.
I think every hand here has gone up. Because I think you've possibly known somebody that if meaning was subtracted from their life, some reason not to get up in the morning, some reason not to have enthusiasm. So it says, I am led by God's presence within me to do something that gives my life meaning, such as being of service or help to others. When a person is neurotic to the nth degree, they are totally wrapped up in a narcissistic world of their own self. It's all about me. That's all that they can see. It's all about me. But when there's nothing more about me that has any meaning, let's say if a person retires as an example. Some people, as we all know, when they retire, they are very, very edgy. Even their personality may change because now whatever they haven't taken care of over the years now begins to surface. It rears its ugly head. Before, they were able to repress it under the guise of all the work and all the accomplishments they were doing in a worldly sense. Now, having been left to their own devices of time on their hands, things change. So my suggestion really is, based upon, again, observing and what human nature is all about, intertwined with the spiritual nature of each and every one of us. The main thing is, whatever stage you are in, always to have something that has meaning to it. Something that you volunteer for. Something that, if you don't volunteer, it's going to do somebody some good besides yourself. Because if it's just about you, those cells, even though they're new every day, will feel old because they won't feel invigorated. So the expression in the Bible, as you give, so you receive, I really believe is a key factor to us remaining younger through each stage that we go through. And I hope that makes sense to you. You'll find more in what you give to somebody else than you will in a cosmetic jar, as far as your state of youthfulness is concerned. And the state of youthfulness, because the title of the subject is Keys to a Longer Quality Life. The word quality is there. And without meaning in your life, I don't care who you are, there isn't any quality. You could be the healthiest person on earth, look terrific, but without meaning, you could find yourself doing all kinds of things that are self-destructive. The bright side of things, the glass half full rather than half empty, the bright side. It says, the longer I live, the more I try to see the bright side of any situation or condition, knowing that God's bright light, love, presence, bright light, love, presence, is the eternal reality hidden oftentimes by the outer appearance of what seems to be contradictions to a bright side. There are two sides to every story. There are two sides to every coin in your pocket or your purse. You can look at things from the negative, you can look at things from the positive, you can look at things from the unaware, and you can look at things from the aware. The choice is continually ours, and we are constantly in a fork in the road within our own mind, having to make a choice. Do we go to the upper or do we go to the lower? Which do we go to? How do we see whatever is taking place? How do we respond to it? We can get into the doldrums, we can get into self-pity, we can get into all kinds of things that are not good for us. Or we can step it up and take the high road, as it were. I believe to have a quality life into the later stages of life as you go through them is to look for the bright side. Try to find the spiritual message. When something goes wrong, okay, what am I learning from this? What is this teaching me? And try to find the bright side of what it's teaching you. Try to find it. If you do, the cells respond. The cells are bright. They're glowing. If you see the negative, the cells grow dull. The negative energy infiltrates. You become self-destructive. I remember H. Spencer Lewis, that started the initial Rosicrucians in San Jose, California, wrote a book that when I first saw the title of it, I thought, boy, that says it all. The name of the book was called Mental Poisoning, of how we mentally poison our bodies. Mental poisoning. I'm throwing that out to sort of dramatize to you, because it's a pretty potent title. Mental poisoning. That is exactly what you do when you are constantly looking at the negative side of things. You're poisoning the new cells of your body, which want to rejuvenate your body. God is giving you a gift through divine design of new cells each and every day. And because you won't forgive, because you won't find meaning in your life, because you won't live with moderation, because you don't see the bright side, then you're poisoning the very thing that is a gift to us. The way we are set up to function and to live is being poisoned. I hope this is making sense to you. Because again, it's living a longer quality life. And finally, enjoyment. Yes, we want meaning. Yes, we want to look on the brighter side. Yes, we want to live a moderate life. Yes, we want to have the right image of ourselves. Yes, we need to meditate every day to be in contact with our divine source. Yes, we need to forgive. We need to release.
Yes.
But let's throw a little seasoning in to the soup. Let's say that there has to be a little bit of enjoyment here. So the affirmation reads, through God's presence within me, I am led to have leisure activities I enjoy with friends who can laugh, have fun, and be supportive of me and I of them. I remember as I was in my 20s and 30s, I had one time one person ask me, said, you know, you're not Jewish, but why do you always have your close circle of friends, why are they always Jewish? I said, because there's more jokes and we laugh more than my Christian friends. I'm telling you the truth. So whatever it takes, whatever your circle of friends, have some laughers, have some people who like to joke, who like to be on the light side of things. It keeps you wonderfully, wonderfully young. Enjoy humor. Friends who can laugh. Have fun. And having fun doesn't mean that you have to take a cruise or you have to spend a lot of money and go to some type of exotic places and so forth. Having fun can be the simplest of things. It really can be. It can be just as simple as going out in your backyard to a garden that you have there and just planting something. It doesn't have to be earth-shaking. And if you have passed into every stage of your life as you've gone along and you've learned anything, it is that it doesn't have to be some big monumental thing. Simple things. And be supportive of me and I of them. And be supportive of me and I of them. Choose friends that in your circle that you feel a natural kinship with, that if they tell you they're not feeling well, you just don't mouth, oh, is that right? Oh, can I be of any help? No. That you actually want to be of help. That it's inside of you, that this person is an integral part of your life, and you really feel that. And if you're not feeling well, that they look at you and you can see the concern. No feigned concern, but real concern. I remember I had one employee, this was many, many, many years ago. And I don't know whether I had eaten something wrong or whatever it was for breakfast, but it was about 11:30 a.m. in the morning, and all of a sudden I started to have chest pains. And the chest pains were pretty severe. And I said to the person, wow, I'm having chest pains. I don't know exactly what's going on. Can you keep an eye on me? Well, yeah, but you know, it's almost my lunchtime. Unbelievable. This is not unusual. It really isn't. It isn't unusual. So in your group of friends, I think that it's very, very important as you go through every stage of life that you select your friends very, very carefully. And you say to yourself, I affirm that God draws to me the right circle of acquaintances. the right circle of acquaintances that are really true friends, that I am really naturally supportive of them, that I show genuine concern if there's something wrong. Genuine concern, it comes from the heart. It doesn't come from the cerebral thing that that's what I'm supposed to do or say. And the same friends that you can laugh with and you can have fun with. Then I really feel that that's a major, major key to living a quality life. That's why I feel oftentimes so many people like George Burns and a lot of others that were comedians lived to be longer and healthier as far as a quality life on into later years is because of the laughter. There's the circle of people that they had around them. So keep those things in mind. Now, I hope that the things that I've shared with you here today, you'll take to heart. And speaking of that, let's go into our hearts where the presence of God exists. If you would you close your eyes and think along with me for a few moments? I turn away from the outer world to enter into the innermost world of my own mind, soul, and spirit, to for a few moments contemplate the great reality, the spiritual essence that is within me. And so I move from the outer me to the inner me, from the personal me to the eternal me, from the human me to the divine me, from that which is, that which will always be. And so I turn my outer senses inward. I turn my sense of sight inward, that the energy that I use for sight is now part of the sight of my soul, that my soul may see. And as I do, I turn my outer senses inward, that I may begin to sense and to feel a greater presence that is within me, and yet infinitely beyond me. I relax. I move inward, to sense and to feel the great presence that is the eternal within myself, to melt away into a clear, restful peace. To feel the serenity of God's Spirit at the center of my soul. To feel the embrace of God surrounding my soul, loving my soul. Giving me a greater state of awareness, clearing my mind, clearing my consciousness, elevating my awareness throughout every part of my body, my awareness in a heightened state of beauty, of peace, of transcendence, a calmness throughout my beingness. Here within myself, I am in the presence of the essence of wholeness, of completeness, the essence of beauty, the essence of renewal, the essence of love, for I am in the presence of the great creator of all things.
living in me and I living in God. One mind, one heart. I am at peace. I am part of the presence. I sit now for a few moments of quietness, feeling that sense of peace throughout the entirety of my beingness, the peace that is God, the presence that is beyond my personal self and yet within it, the reality that is God. In a few moments, I'll slowly begin to open my eyes and my senses to the exterior world around me, but I will retain an inner sensing of the reality of God's presence within me to lead me and to guide me, to direct me and to heal me, to bring me peace and to love me. And so ever so slowly now I'll begin to open my eyes. And as I open my eyes, I'll stretch my arms and hands high over my head in a symbolic gesture of always reaching for something higher in my life, knowing that that something higher that I reach for is to be found in the height of who and what I truly am within myself. A living, breathing manifestation of the stars and of the heavens, having taken image, shape, form, and embodiment, and I bring down my hands, resting in the peace and the security that this is so, and so it is.